welcome to day two of the E-Tailing India Expo 2016 here at the Sahara Star, Mumbai. E-Tailing is in its fourth year and it has grown into the largest expo for the e-commerce, retail, and mobile industry in India. We begin first with a keynote address from the ex-CMO of Reliance and Reliance Jio, Andrew Campbell. Now, Andrew will be speaking on digital and how digital and traditional retail are coming together to provide a seamless experience for consumers. Andrew brings with him a unique blend of tactical, practical, and creative experience, having over 35 years in senior management positions across the world. Now, Andrew is the managing director and co-founder of Factor X Retail, which I'll let him speak a bit more about. And prior to founding Factor X and prior to Reliance, Andrew actually had a very prolific worldwide career that spanned many customer-centric brands, including Nike globally, Walmart in Mexico, Tesco in UK and Asia, and Safeway in the UK. He's worked on operations, trading, property services, marketing, and branding, and has led major projects across both telecom and the retail industry. He's a specialist, mind you, in strategy planning with deep expertise and proven experience in building and implementing brand and omni-channel marketing strategy.
Factor X Retail, we specialize in retail and we specialize in telecom, and I'm not really going to speak much more about it. I'm sure those that want to know more about it can catch up with me later. As our host has just explained, I launched the first Nike Town stores. I took Walmart into Mexico. I launched, for those who may remember, in the 1998, we launched jungle.com, which in the UK was the first $10 million dot-com business. Launched the O2 brand, worked across Tesco and Reliance. So, I'm basically a retailer. And retail is a very simple business. You buy stuff, you move it, you display it, you promote it. Is it on? Okay. You promote it and you sell it. But as retailers, fundamentally, we do the same thing. What we actually do is we just continually reimagine new and better ways to do it. And what do I mean by that? Once upon a time, let's go back to the 30s. This was the shopkeeper. Good morning, Mrs. James. How's your wonderful family doing? I seem to recall that Jessica's birthday's coming up soon. Have you thought what you might be buying her? And what about your boy Charles? Is he still planning to join the army? Now that's a relative conversation in the 30s. Isn't that customer relationship management today? How can I help you? Usual items today, or is there something special? I've got some new tea in store today. Would you like to try some? I know how much you like your teas. Isn't that recommendation and upsell? I've got some big, juicy red apples, delivered this morning fresh. And I've taken the liberty of putting some aside for you. I know you like fresh fruit, and they're only a penny a pound. Isn't that what we call basket analysis? And it's been a while since you last bought flour and sugar. Shall I put some in your grocery order this week? Isn't that developing transactional data? Did your husband enjoy the lovely meatloaf last week? It's on special offer this week, and I can give you a discount on the potatoes. Isn't that targeted deals and promotions? And would you like to pay for that now? or shall I put it on the old slate and you can pay me at the end of the month? Isn't that secure credit? Don't they know that customer well enough to give them credit? And isn't that what customer loyalty and retention is all about? Now, for most of the audience here today, being India, that's Kirana stores. Nothing different. It's all about serving the customer. So, shall I get that boxed up for you and have it delivered by our boy today? Would you like it around 4 p.m.? Isn't that free home delivery? And isn't that convenience and service? So fundamentally, what's changed? Now, this is a little tongue-in-cheek, but I think you'll get the message.
We're so glad you're here. In order to enter our exclusive store, I'm just going to need your...
I know it's a little tongue-in-cheek, but the principle's the same. Once upon a time, it was about the direct relationship between the customer and the shopkeeper. And then we started to target Mrs. Jones with digital technologies, with smart technology, but the fundamental purpose was the same. And what next? We're moving to the omni-channels, moving across mobile, online, digital, etc. But it's not just these three, it's also on the move, it's also in the home, it's also at the office, it's also about product advocates, etc. But there are very few good examples around the world of true omni-channel success stories. Most of the stories you hear about in the omni-channel world are not omni-channel, they're multi-channel. And where do they exist? Most of the empowering big stories in omni-channel are being driven not by e-play, not by digital players, not by e-coms. They're being driven by the traditional big box retailers. And I'll explain a little bit why that is the case later. So as a retailer, the holy grail for successful omnichannel is not the multi-channel presence. It's important. It's important, of course. But it's actually about streamlined, efficient, and viable supply chains. In the omni-channel world, if you don't have a great supply chain, your omni-channel business is dead. The key is the supply chain. Now, pure play retailers will claim, oh, but you know, we don't have the stores, we don't have that cost. That's very true. But what they forget is that in an omni-channel world, they're not stores, they're showrooms, and above all, their warehouses. This is where product can be shipped to locally in the vicinity where the customer is. It also provides the third and perhaps most important part of omnichannel is the click and play. Why is that important? This Christmas, John Lewis in the UK generated 19% of its sales from online shoppers. But the biggest e-coms, Boohoo and Amazon in the UK, they delivered 21 and 25% respectively. But they're significantly bigger players in the e-com space. But here's the rub. 78% of John Lewis's online orders were collected from the store. So for that retailer, there was no on-cost. So they have made savings that have been able to pass them on, which is why this Christmas they made profits. Amazon and Boohoo are not making the profits. So who's doing omnichannel well? Just a quick show of hands. How many are retailers in the audience today? Actually sell. Not. So the rest of you are service sector, yeah? Okay. So who's doing omnichannel well? Everybody familiar with the Macy's story?
I think the aha moment for us was 4 or 5 years ago when we really started to understand the impact that Macy's.
So fundamentally what they're doing is they're taking one channel and focusing on one customer. What makes it successful is the piece that wasn't mentioned in the film. It's the fact that they're always in stock. And they're in stock because they've got a bloody good supply chain. So we still do retail the same way. The fundamentals are exactly the same. So this is, I'm just going to take you through a very quick model on how we would develop a retail business. So in the center, you will always have a core foundation that is based around your brand strategy, your business strategy or your business model, your insights that you're going to learn from and use to drive your business, and your financial model. These are the four pieces of the jigsaw that every business should have in place. And then we look for the right location. Now, this has always been the retail mantra: location, location, location. It was drummed into me when I was my store manager way back. But what does location mean today? Location today might not just mean stores. It might mean where you're placing warehouses. It's based around where your customers are. So that might mean that you're doing regional work across your e-com business. Everybody assumes that e-com has to be big and it has to go across the entire of India. It does not. You can work it very, very closely into very niche regions if you so wish. You have to have the right store, the right format. It means format, whether that's website or store, or big store or small store. You have to have the right product offer. And the challenge here is the nature of the product being offered. It's more challenging ask when you're a consolidator, as many retail, many e-com businesses are, or an aggregator or a facilitation e-com business. But you still have to know what your physical product offer is going to run. You have to have the right support services, so your IT services, your financial services, etc. Quite often in new startups, this would all get outsourced. The supply chain, as I've mentioned before, is key. How are you going to move your stock? Because it's a cost derivative. And the cost of supply chain is going up and up and up across the world. You have to have the right operation, the right people, and of course the right communication. And fundamentally, that's your basic model. And you are consistently trying to take that model and always do things better and strive to do things simpler and strive to do things faster and strive to do things cheaper. And that's everybody's business model. But there is a fundamental retail principle that I want to share with you first that I believe is going to change the way we go forward over the coming years. So, firstly, let's be clear. As a retailer, it's not about what the customer buys. As a retailer, I don't care what brand of shampoo they buy. All I care about as the retailer is they buy the shampoo from me. Now, if you're P&G, what brand of shampoo you sell is very, very important. They don't care where the sale gets made. What's interesting with the Macy model, I'm dead. What's interesting with the Macy model is they are now doing exactly what I've just described for the FMCG world. They are now saying, I do care about the product you're buying, and I don't care where you buy it. I don't care if you buy it in my store or online or on the move, or as long as you're buying Macy product. And the second biggest challenge that you face is making sure that you're accessible and you're affordable in all the channels that you're going to serve your customers. So wherever they're shopping, you need to have a presence, and that presence needs to be accessible and it needs to be affordable. And the biggest factor that's going to affect the whole retail industry, price. It's always been the key issue in retail, and it will continue to do so. In modern trade, retail price has been merged with a perception of value. Many years ago, in supermarket retailing, at my days at Walmart and Tesco, it was price wars. Now it's the price war still there, but it's more about the value and the value proposition. And we're all racing down a route that's going to take retailers into a new space where they're going to have to revisit the way they do their business models and the way they do their finance plans. So If you'll just share with me this video. I'd like you all just to watch this video for a moment. It's quite short.
Into this dream. I must have been the only person in the world who didn't know.
I love you.
You must be.
Does anybody here not know what brand that is? It's Chanel. Okay, so what I would like you all to do is think of that bottle of Chanel. That's their logo, that's their identity. And that's their product. So what I'd like you all to do is put a value on that. We'll call it X. Everybody happy? That bottle of Chanel is worth X. What happens if you buy it here? If you go to Harrods and you have it personally serviced by a personal shopper, what are you going to pay? You've all just gone X plus. Why? When you get home and put that bottle of Chanel on your sideboard, it's the same product, the brand values haven't changed, nothing's changed. So why was it X plus? Because of the experience. What happens if you buy it here? X. You're buying it on the high street. What happens if you buy it here? You've all gone X minus. Suddenly, it has to be cheaper. But here's the rub, guys. What happens if you buy it here? You've all gone X minus minus. Because everything you buy on the internet, everything you buy online, has to be cheaper. Because the customer says so. That's the perception, and that's become the reality. What happens if you buy it here? What happens if you buy it on a mobile? And I'm talking about the sale. What does a mobile generate its sales through? Promotions and deals. That's what the mobile does. It's the world of promotions and deals. Yes, you can search. Yes, you could do other things. But what it fundamentally does is push deals and promotions to you. Now, if you're buying deals and promotions, what are you going to pay? You've all gone X minus, minus, minus. So what does that mean fundamentally? Fundamentally, it means there is a channel that is X plus. There is a channel that is X. There is a channel that is X minus. There is a channel that is X minus minus. And there is a channel that is X minus minus minus. Now, if you're going to work in the omni-channel business and you're going to aggregate all of those, by pure definition, your price is going to come down. The price that you're going to have to offer that product to the customer is going to get lower. If the price comes down and you want to make money, we have to find a way to reduce our costs. So if these price channels continue to strengthen as they have been doing, and in the mind of the consumer they become quite firm, I will not buy anything online that's not cheaper, then we're in a very different game over the next 5 to 10 years. Omnichannel is the only way you can play because you will have to buy for less. You'll need to be able to leverage scale, you'll need to buy smart, and you'll need to change your specifications or your range mix because you're gonna have to buy for less. You're gonna have to operate for less. You have to take your costs out of somewhere. Supply chain is one of the fundamental pieces of that cost. And you're going to have to sell for less. Across all of those channel areas, you're going to have to sell for less. So how's this going to affect the Indian retailer? Just four snips from recent clips. All of them basically saying that pure play e-com doesn't make money. Why doesn't it make money? Well, let's first of all look at the obvious facts. How can a retail market, India, that is not developed or matured and is trying to emulate the same global markets, how can it do it? when the essential elements of omnichannel retailing are not in India. You don't have a strong modern trade business in, industry. So how can you possibly operate in it? It's not there to operate in. Secondly, the big growth is tiny. Everyone talks about the growth of e-com. It's true, it's growing fast. But it actually only accounts for 0.3% of the total retail sales in India. And it's about 5% of total modern trade. And the lion's share of that, then with 70% of it, comes from the travel industry. So given that you've got so many e-com retail sites currently not making money, even after years of operation, I'm talking about the big global players, why does India feel that it's going to be different? One thing you do have in India is a vast number of people. So what I suspect will happen is that there will be lots and lots and lots of Kirana stores moving into e-com. So the Kirana store will have an e-com site, still performing in a very similar way, but the e-com will grow. So you'll have lots of small e-com retailers. So the single channel is drafted out. I think where India will be over the next 2 to 3 years is actually in multi-channel and moving into cross-channel. I don't think it will do a lot of omni-channel work yet because, as I said earlier, the modern trade infrastructure is not there yet. The supply chain infrastructure just is not there. The roads, the networks, the delivery capability just isn't available yet to manage vast volume. It's expensive. But it will come. And then, of course, there's the changing face of the consumer. So what's Mrs. Jones going to be like in 2020? So as retailers, we've got to be smart when we're building our plans. The value of the experience has to be taken into the plan. We have to know where we're going to, where the sizzle is going to be sold, because the sizzle is not usually where the sale is made. And we've got to make sure we've got our supply chain. Great video, but made by Americans for Americans. You've got a customer in control. You've got a customer who's marketing savvy. You've got a customer who is very perceptive on channels. But you know what? This is India. You've got a population of 1 billion people. 600 million of those people never even experienced the internet. 700 million of them don't even have a smartphone. And for many, many millions, Facebook's never been experienced. And Google search has never been tried. And e-wallet's a complete brain teaser. So just because it's been in existence in other markets, developed mature markets, doesn't mean it's dead in this market. Far from it. So what would precipitate such a change? How could India and India's and Indians become more empowered with the digital tools? What would make that happen in India? A seamless, convergent, high-speed network? On the move, in the home, on the go? A cheap devices to connect to the network, Wi-Fis, MiFis, dongles, dangles, gateways, etc. Integrated service solutions across all verticals, so health, education, security, finance, business, etc. cheap consumption devices, so smart mobiles, smart tablets, TVs, gadgets, accessories, rich and valuable content. If you've got a fast network, if you've got cheap connection, guess who? But India, watch out. It's very true that you are the leaders in IT development. It's also true that you've got a huge opportunity to leapfrog the world in the provision of digital content. And it's also true that you have the capability to be the growth leaders in e-retail. But beware, because Generation A is already after your jobs. Quick show of hands. How many people in the audience today can code? Put your hands up if you can actually code. One, two, three, four. Three, four. Four of you can code. Watch this. This is the UK today.
Students playing around with computers is a common sight these days, but this is no game. These children are actually learning the basics of coding.
It's fun. And when someone says coding, you think it's like really, really, really hard. And then like you just go up to people and say, I know how to code.
This key skill is now compulsory in all schools in the United Kingdom from the age of five. It's not just about
compulsory in schools from the age of five.
The tools these children are using are much more user-friendly.
Coding is on the national curriculum
with their other lessons.
So watch out, India. Your jobs are in jeopardy. Thank you very much. Want me to take questions or? Any questions? Gentleman over here.
What is Factor X Retail or about?
Well, we're only 6 months old, and it is myself and a team of people from the retail businesses that I've worked in, so some ex-Tesco, some ex-Walmart. There are also some ex-Reliance people there. We're based out of Thailand. And what we do is we work on retail consulting projects to develop and grow businesses.
Help what businesses is the targeted develop. Audience? Is it India? Is it UK?
Sorry?
Targeted audience? Is it in
No, India? Worldwide.
Worldwide.
But we see India as a great opportunity for us. I spent 5 years here with Reliance, so I've got some Indian experience, albeit Reliance'd. For those who know Reliance, know what I mean.
Thank you.
Any more? Okay, well, thank you very much. I'll be around for the day if anybody wants to drop me in, follow it up. Thank you, bye-bye.